Hey guys, hope you're doing well tonight. I just wanted to jump in and make a quick video now that I have some free time tonight and just show you what the Lord's been showing me with the end times, mainly the mark of the beast, but also just little things here and there and just going from Daniel, the idea of Daniel and Daniel's vision and John's vision and Revelation. And the reason we can kind of link those two up obviously together because Daniel sees more of the false prophet. Daniel sees more of a tabernacle, that more Old Testament type, and linking the stones. He gets more of just that beautiful image, that obviously type of fallen angel, but linking it more to a false prophet type. Obviously, there's still more detail in it with, for the four beasts that rise up, and we can link it to Revelation, but that's what's so amazing, because Daniel has its own. And John has its own in Revelation. And the thing isn't what I wanted to show you guys too, but what's so amazing, what's so perfect too, is just how it's just it lines up amazingly, and how obviously Christ is God, Christ is the Spirit of the living God. It all lines up. Daniel was speaking to Christ, Moses was speaking to Christ, Abraham was speaking to Christ, and Paul was speaking to Christ, Timothy was speaking to Christ. Timothy had prophecy. It doesn't matter. All the disciples, the apostles, they all spoke to Christ. And it's the same with the prophets because Christ is God. So, and it's just so amazing because whether we link it to John and Revelation, and we see obviously by the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, which is Christ, the ghost being the ghost of Christ inside of us, being the same one that they had talked to, the same God that they talked to in the Old Testament, the prophets. And that's what's amazing. That's why we can link it up with Daniel. We can link up Moses. We can link up Elijah. We can link up Ezekiel. We can link up anybody in the Old Testament and line it up exactly with Christ and line it up with the characters of those of Christ, because the characters of those of Christ and those linked in the scriptures all walked by the Spirit of God. And it's all perfectly. That's what's so amazing about it, is that it lines up with each other. That's why you cannot deny the New Testament in the Old Testament. I mean, obviously people try and do it, but you can't deny it. And that's why you can't deny them together. You can't have the Old Testament without the New Testament, because if there's an Old Testament, obviously there's a coming of a new covenant, a New Testament, which Christ already fulfilled that. So when you have the New Testament, you can't have that without the Old Testament, because the Old Testament prophesies about the New Testament. And it's just amazing. And it's all Christ. Christ is the center and the foundation. And yeah, it's just the Spirit. And man, I was just listening to you guys. You guys are so amazing, man. The Church of God and just God's people. And man, you guys are just so awesome. And I don't know what you guys are gonna do, man. I don't know what you're gonna do. You're gonna die and you're gonna stand in front of God and you're gonna be guilty for absolute murder. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. That was a bloodbath. But no, it's just the Spirit of the living God. So obviously I'm just being silly, and everything that it comes down to is the Lord God working through us. So it's all by His ways. And yeah, you guys are just so awesome, and it's still going too, man. Just give praise and glory to God, and just listening to you guys, and it's just like, wow. And it's still going too. You guys are so amazing, man. God is so amazing working through you. You see how it's a family and it's together, and it doesn't matter what happens over here. If something happens over here, it's a family that just comes together, man. There's nothing like it whatsoever. And that's why it just blows my mind. Absolutely. It just absolutely blows my mind. You guys are so amazing. And it's glory to God through you guys. And that's family. That's family. That's true love. And that's why nobody, you look at everything in life, you look at what's going on, you look at the scriptures. I mean, you look at everything, meaning, I mean, come down to the tiniest detail. I mean, just feeling, itself, skin, everything, clothes. But the way that the Spirit of God moves throughout the church, man, that is amazing. That's how you know it's absolutely alive. That's how you know it's a true family. That's how you know it's the truth, and nothing will shake the truth. Nothing will ever come against the truth. That's how you know it's pure love, a pure foundation, pure family. And it's just, man, like, it just is every day when you guys know about it. I mean, you guys grow with God. You know how it is when we live with God, walk with the Lord. Life will be up and down, but obviously we stay in Him, and it's just it every day, even though it might seem hard at the moment. Through those tribulations, through those hardships, we give Him glory. We have faith. I know it's easier said than done. Shaping, molding, discipline. The more you go through it, the easier it'll be. Trust me, it's easier said than done. But you look back on it and you reflect, and it's just you give Him praise. You give Him honor just like every day. Like the more and more life goes on, it's just like it's so amazing. When you're truly born of the Spirit, that same Spirit that is alive through you guys, the Spirit of the living God, through His church, it's just life and life more, like way more. I mean, people just don't understand. Yeah, life and more abundantly, like eternal life, relationship with the Son, more and more detail, understanding, knowledge, wisdom, and wisdom to line it up, to know how to use it with life. It's just, man, I don't even know what to say. And like, thinking about it and growing with the Lord and just being, and just even recently, months ago, I thought that it couldn't get, like, you know how it is. Like, obviously, you'll never get your mind completely wrapped around the Lord, but it's just like the way it grows more and more, and you grow with Him in a relationship, and just like every day, you're just like, man, how can it get even any more better with Him? Like, He is just, and that's what it is. It's not even about not being completely satisfied. It's just like, man, when you guys know about it, when you have the relationship with the true and living God, it's just like every day it's just like better and better. And there obviously might be times, a couple days in there where it's rough, but then afterwards, man, it's awesome. But yeah, I don't know what you guys are going to do. I don't know what you guys are going to do, what you guys are going to say when you stand in front of the Lord. Yeah, just let the Spirit work through him, man. That's awesome. And just, that's what happens when the wolves in sheep's clothing come against the true and living God, and come against the gospel, and come against the family and the body of Christ. But I apologize. What I was saying too, and what I want to kind of show you guys, and what I was really going over with the Lord today, actually, it was amazing. I love the scripture so much. I apologize if I say that, if you guys couldn't tell. But with John and Revelation by the Spirit, and linking it up, obviously, with Daniel's specific. The reason I pointed out Daniel, why I was focused with Daniel, is because Daniel focuses on more of the false prophet. And then when we get, I mean, obviously, there's more detail in there, and we can take an end time, because we see that Daniel sees the coming of Christ, just like John does. And that's why we can line it up perfectly. But when we see John and we get Revelation, obviously, it's a little bit more spread out, a little bit more detail, end times, you know, tribulation, a type of future in heaven. Try and wrap your mind around heaven when John is taken up. Obviously, there's things, you know, that cannot be said about heaven, but try and wrap around your mind around what is said. And yeah, it's just amazing. So with John, you get more widespread, a little bit more detail, if you would. And that's only because it's, you know, Daniel's is just bunched into, when you go to like Daniel chapter 2, Daniel chapter 7, Daniel 13, 14, if you would, a little bit. But then you have all of Revelation, sorry. Ah, it's my jaw, I apologize. My jaw and the arthritis, and I keep bringing it up, but what happens is the way it moves it out of place so much to where I end up talking in a weird way, so it dries my mouth out a little bit more. So with John and with Revelation, we obviously get more of the future too, but the kingdom, you know, New Jerusalem, we get the 1,000-year reign, the millennial, we get judgment. And then with Revelation, we can also line it up too. I mean, you can line up Daniel, but you can line up Revelation entirely almost with the scripture and just how it it's spread out alone, because it's all about future, because we're in the grace period, the church age right now. So that's just what I was focusing on and just what I was going over with astrology, the tribes, the stones, with more of the tabernacle and the false prophet, linking up all of the religions. Obviously, when we went to Genesis through the meanings of leaf, linking it to Isis. You can link, obviously, Isis, Ishtar, which is just the devil, Satan, all throughout. I mean, Baal, Moloch, that's the goddess behind it. The Statue of Liberty, if you would. Your golden image that turned green in the sun. Because America is type of Babylon. It's just Babylon's of a spirit, like, obviously. But there's a, when we look at Revelation and that type of spirit, and you look at the city, Babylon will be referenced to in end times, mainly Egypt. So, with that, with Daniel, so now with John and with Revelation, we can also link up Daniel, but now we're going to kind of get into tying in more of the actual mark and then tying it in to with just bringing it all together with the different religions, because you take the false prophet and then you take the Antichrist, the beast, if you would, who will come linking the religions, being the savior of the world, who's obviously not. So how to do so with the false prophet being there, the all by the destruction of what we see going on in the world today. I mean, there's all links, but we're going to take it and we're going to tie it in. Those stones, the astrology, the religions through the false prophet with the types of mandibles, and it's the spirit, because the religion is a huge, obviously, main part about it. And I call it religion because it's fake. It's religion. If it's not a relationship with the true and living God, then it's a religion. And that's what it is. It's bringing all the religions together under that false prophet, linking it to the Antichrist to give praise and worship to the dragon, Satan. So in doing that, we're going to link in the mark, link in what we see in the world today, kind of how it's going on physically, what we see with the physical eyes, kind of the destruction and the annihilation, if you would, from the inside out. Funny, if we talk about New York and we talk about Revelation 9:11, where it says they had a king over him, a king of the bottomless pit, and his name is Hebrew. And in Hebrew, it's Abaddon, and in Greek, it's Apollyon. You look at what happened on that date. I got to be careful with what I say. I mean, even now, with this, now, what's going to be next? But it was a controlled demolition, just like what we see going on in the world today. Just like it all has the character and the nature of the enemy, a controlled demolition, just like what happens on the inside. It happened in heaven first. It happened in the garden. Happens in the church. Happens inside the body. Inside, it's a controlled inside demolition. Bring down the first to bring in the new. Tower of Babel, all under one. And so we're going to do that, showing what the Lord is showing me, showing many others around the world, just linking it together. And so we're going to just continue doing that. And eventually, because I'm going to show you what he's been showing me too, just without history, because it all... That's what, like, it's all about just the repeating, because that's what happens. It's not that the Lord keeps it repeating. That's just what happens with sin. When we keep denying the Lord and keep going our own ways and keep going after wickedness, it's the same thing's going to happen over and over and over again. It's eventually going to get to the point to where God needs to destroy it and take it out himself. So, yeah, we're going to go over that. We're going to link up... I'll show you. We'll just go over it. So I just apologize, because if I start going over all that, it's going to take too much time. I'll just jump in and show you guys. So, and I'm sorry if I'm like, you know, like, hurry up here. I've been like just waiting all day patiently, and I've just been so excited to just tell you guys. It's just amazing listening to you guys. So, yeah, usually when the enemy runs away too, that's how you know. It's like a type of mercy. That's how you know that it's like over. They just flee. They'll go away. And you know, I was listening to it, like it's not even worth it anymore. Like it's been utterly just completely destroyed time and time again. It's honestly just not even worth it anymore. It's just leaving. I think it's gotten to the point to where it's like yeah, I don't even know. Like, dang. That's a bloodbath. You guys are awesome. And it's all just the Lord working through you guys, man. But, so I was listening to it because I still have brothers there. And I just obviously am going to see what, obviously going to see what they have to say. And it's funny because the guy who they had there, I have nothing against him. I actually like his preaching. I actually do. And I bet he's a really cool guy. And it's just sad to see some people, they just kind of get caught up with that in situations like that. So, you know, I just pray that that brother has just enough faith and boldness to stay strong in the Lord. And I mean, obviously, I'm not saying don't stay there. I would never say that. I would just say, just follow the Lord, have faith in the Lord. And if he's telling you and pulling on your heart and showing you, you'll know. If you truly have faith and truly trust the Lord, he'll guide you. And yeah, I kind of like his preaching. But if you want to get down to it, man, I'll just show you how silly it is. And just that's how you know, man, when the enemy just flees, man, it's like a beg for mercy. That's how you know it's just completely over. And they just flee, scatter. It's like, boom, when the light comes on, like rats, like there's a rat and like cockroaches, they scatter. And that's what's funny, too, because I mean, deep down, I knew, obviously, too, because we're going to get into it, because I don't know how I felt about the Jacob and Esau, because I was letting it go. I mean, obviously, there's things here and there, but we'll get into that, too. Clearly, and it's funny, because the enemy always gives himself away, and you give it patience, you give it time. It's all just on the Lord. It's never just about, like, you know, revenge. Obviously, nobody's perfect, especially when it has to do with a personal attack. So, but you wait for the Lord's time, and the Lord's timing's perfect, and you know that it's there, you know that it's coming, that it's linking up, and then the enemy always gives himself away because he flees, he can't handle it, he can't take it. The light just comes in, and it's just like, man, you guys are so awesome. The Lord is so amazing, man, working through you guys. We'll go over that too, but I was listening to this brother, and you know, obviously he's told what to say. You mean, you watch the camera comes on, and you know, they're looking around, you know, okay, cool. Imagine having to wait for the camera to start the service instead of just starting the service, and then whenever the camera gets on. But you see the priorities, and you see one brother walking in front of the camera, and you can totally tell he gives him a thumbs up. He walks by and he gives him the, okay, yeah, cool, the camera's on, go ahead. And you know, all right, sweet. And I have nothing against this guy. I mean, obviously, that's the sad part about it, is what these false teachers, because they, you see the spirit behind it, it's not the Holy Spirit. You see a spirit of fear. It's a cowardness. It's a type of rat. They can never direct it straight on. And they flee, they scatter. And what they do is they'll get other people, especially new people, those who are type of weaker. And I apologize. I think I might have went after one guy maybe a little bit rough. Not linking it, obviously, to the actual main, false teacher. The more it goes on, the more I'm obviously seeing that, and just tying it all in. I mean, obviously they're not, I would never say that they're all false. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying I think that you can clearly see that it's a type of cultish leadership, type of weird Pentecostal New Age demonic movement. And I'm not saying that the people in there, because I truly believe that brothers and sisters love the Lord Jesus, even the ones who preach. I mean, I like the guy who preached and who was saying these things. That's why I say it's not them. It's the one behind it, and it's the one who's leading, and it all comes down to. And so they'll throw them out like guinea pigs. That's why I'm starting to understand now. I'm not going to go directly at them because it's not, they'll throw the guinea pigs out because they can't handle it themselves. And one thing that I heard him say too, let me see here. Yeah, okay, so I mean, honestly, the main thing about it, because I didn't even listen to the whole thing, I mean, you see what happens at the beginning, but you hear him say, you know, if you want to, they'll leave out husband, but notice if you want to pray about, you know, boyfriend, girlfriend, wife, it's just interesting. And then you hear him say, if you have any problems sleeping, I take that's probably because I'm doing videos at night. I don't know. They're going to say, oh, this guy, he's selfish. I mean, come on now. I guess they don't realize that there's other time in the day. I guess they don't realize that. Maybe in between working and what I have and what I have coming down to it, maybe I can slip in maybe a little nap here. And it's how the Lord works, because I have a life outside of the phone that you guys don't see, that I walk with the Lord, walk with my family, and just growing and being with, you know, the body. But you hear him talk about, it's like if you have problems, issue, maybe taking drugs, narcotics, and he looks down, he forgot the name of it, he forgot the name of the narcotic, because he calls it barbiturates. For sleep. You guys do realize a barbiturate, the main example of a barbiturate is phenobarbital, because that's what my dog takes, and that's what I've been saying. But hey, you know what? It's not about me. That's right. I apologize. I'm just a prideful, selfish, arrogant. Obviously, I'm not perfect, but hey. So yeah, could you imagine? Could you imagine the people on the sleep? Oh yeah, that's another thing. They said he... And I'm not going directly at him, because obviously I think he's told what to say, except for when he starts preaching. But you hear him say, you know, we just want to worship you with you. We just want to gather with you. Guys, they're not gathering and they're not worshiping. So, you know, it's like, hey, you know, we just want to come and we just want to lift the Lord up with you. Hey, guys, I don't know if you know this or not, but they're not lifting up the Lord. So, I don't know. And another thing too, could you imagine the people on the street? I, you know, mainly thought maybe it was heroin, cocaine, crystal meth, flocka, you know, maybe that they were on the streets, but not barbiturates. Hey, what's up, man? Hey, how you doing, bro? Hey, you got any of that crystal? No, I don't have any crystal, but I got that barb. I got that pheno. What's the pheno? Have you ever had that epilepsy medication? It does absolutely nothing. I think what they realized, and I've never taken a barbiturate before, because it has no effect. Why would you take a... I mean, I think it has like a little bit effect. I think there is like a... What's the name of it? You can if you take a lot of it, but it's pointless. I think what they meant to say was benzodiazepine. That's what'll help you sleep. And that's more of a narcotic. That's more of a psychoactive. Barbs, not so much. More of epilepsy. Which is, that's how you know it. It's just funny. But I wanna go here real quick. Because, I mean, you can take anything and it will make you tired. Mainly what it's prescribed for, though, is epilepsy. But, I mean, this is the same type of thing that you see coming from people who say that they know about it, and know about smoking the cannabis, and then getting locked behind bars and then having to smoke orange peels. Yeah, I don't know how to tell you guys this, but that's not traits of a cannabis smoker. I've been around plenty of cannabis smokers. I was a cannabis smoker for most of my entire life, and I've never gone to the point to where I've had to smoke orange peels. That's more of a crack cocaine type of a user. And I've never used crack cocaine, but I've been around it. I've never used heroin, but I've been around it. There was a time where people started smoking heroin where I was, and I had to leave. I can't be around that. Like, what are you doing? They just whip it out. I'm like, what are you doing? I can't be around this. And besides actually what was cut in with the what I told you guys about my testimony where I almost overdosed and died, grace be to God, glory given to God for his grace, that was cut with heroin. And I was told that it was, the other part of it was cut with the type of PCP. What they did was dipped a chunk of paper into the liquid and then formed it into the pill itself. But I think it was actually a type of flocka. That's why I had such a reaction to it. That's why you guys have to be, you know, careful. Just don't do it, because, man, it's just not good all around whatsoever. However you want to look about it, it's just not good. It's not worth it either whatsoever. I've done it all. I've done the most. It's not worth it. I mean, I've done everything except meth and heroin, so, and crack. So, but it's really not worth it. So, nothing really you expect there. I think what they were thinking of benzodiazepines, you know. Hey, Titus boy. Good boy. Wake up, bud. Good boy. You know, Xanax, something like that. That's usually more what people would take. But yeah, I mean, they just flee. So that's really all. Just wanted to point out there, I thought it was funny. I'm not going after that guy specifically because it's the one behind it. But man, you guys are awesome. I want to give the Lord glory through you guys. But yeah, could you imagine? Hey, what's up, bro? You know, do you got any of that crystal? Do you, you got any of that ice? No. But have you ever had Fanadorm? Huh? Have you ever had that Fanadorm? No. It's that barb, bro. Can you hit me up with some of that sodium amytal? Yeah. I had to give it. Titus, stop, dude. I gave it all, man. Lost my car. Lost my job. Lost my home. Lost my family. All of it. It was that pheno, man. That sodium siconal. It's rough, bro. Rough. So. But yeah. Anyway, so just wanted to go over that, and you guys are so awesome. And then another thing, too, about the enemy exposes itself. He always runs and hides, always in the mix of us, but you never see, it's never a direct, always very subtle. They'll say stuff like, we're going to go off feelings now. We're going to go off feelings now, even though they've been going off feelings for the last 6 months, complete feelings, because they're hypocrites, they're narcissists. They're wolves in sheep's clothing. And let's get this straight, too. The very first rapture was in the garden with Adam and Eve. So whatever the enemy thinks that the first rapture is, that wasn't the first rapture. The first rapture is here in the garden. The rib, which was taken. So the Lord caused Adam to... a deep sleep to fall on him. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 6. I don't want you guys to be ignorant. Now all of us will sleep. He took out of his rib and closed up the flesh in place. Type of being brought up in the spirit. Rib was taking, which the Lord had taken from man. He made into a woman, a type of bride, and he brought her to the man. Type of Christ. The final Adam. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh, and she will be called woman, a type of marriage, because she was taken out of man. Literally. But Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And they were both naked, and the man and his wife were not ashamed before the tribulation. New bodies, but marriage. So, I mean, we can go all day. And it's easy, too. When I look at it, it's easy. Easy. So with this Jacob and Esau, the enemy always likes to put himself in the type of scriptures, too. He's very subtle about it, very good. But he always likes to twist it, too. Twist the meaning, take out of it. Even though Hebrews will say, by faith, Isaac blessed both Jacob and Esau. Even though Isaac blessed them both, it doesn't mean that the Lord did. There was still a prophecy that came down and was going to Jacob. So whether Isaac wanted to go a certain way about it, it doesn't matter. It was what the Lord had. It was a prophecy beforehand because it was the Lord's will. Even though the way Jacob and his mother went about it, obviously lying, going behind the back, none of us are perfect, that's fine. The Lord still would have figured out a way anyway. Even if they wouldn't have done it, the Lord still would have figured out a way for Jacob to rule and to have this blessing. So it doesn't matter. They'll always try and put themselves in the context, twist it around, take it away, make it about man, make it about works, just like they do Matthew chapter 7 and 6, not about faith. And it's the same type of people that think that it's about prophecy, will push prophecy, but they've been pushing the same prophecy for over 12 years, and there's no actual detail, nothing lines up, it's the same thing. Give me a true prophecy, give me a detailed prophecy. Don't give me one that's been the same year, same for 12 years that you can find on the news. And that's another thing too. Enemy always liking to be self-righteous, wanting to put himself and have glory. Even though Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau, it doesn't matter. We can look at it as the enemy. The enemy is still the anointed cherub. He's the only anointed angel, but he's still the enemy. So, however you want to go about that, it doesn't rely on what man does. And even if there's a certain type of blessing, you want to take that blessing wasn't the same and wasn't meant. And it lines up with prophecy for God's will of Jacob and what was to come with Jacob. Because the enemy, even though the enemy was still anointed, you see the blessing that the enemy had, what was the, because of who the enemy was in heart, because of what he did in heart, what had happened. So you see how the enemy will try and twist it around, but it's easy. We can go all day, all day. Once you truly, if truly want to get into it and do it, absolutely shatter, just like before. They'll try and mock Matthew chapter 6, make it about, oh yeah, well, they didn't have enough time. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Because it's always just about a ritual. You see the foolishness that comes out of the mouth. And what he didn't realize and what they don't understand is the disciples were already saved. So that context and the context of it would just be merely reaching out to him. But Peter was seeing it by the physical eyes. When Peter was doing so, he was doing it, reaching out. But obviously, yes, that's all it takes in the heart. And that's what it comes down to in Matthew. But one thing that you notice he'll leave out, and it's the same thing with the simple ABCs of salvation, because it's not just a prayer. If salvation is not just a prayer, what's left out? The blood and the new birth. So that's what it is. He'll try and mock and try and take away from the Lord, Word of God, the prayer that he's laid down for us. Because what doesn't it have? It doesn't have the blood and it doesn't have the new birth. Because all these people care about is numbers. All they care about is self-righteous fame. That's why you hear them say, oh, this is all I have to do. All I have to do. Because they lay burdens on other people saying, what are you doing for the Lord on your time off, on your free time? And then yet they don't do anything. And yet this is all they have to do is just come in behind a pulpit. That's so weird. You know, I thought it was a blessing. I thought it was a gift. But you see how the enemy always traps himself and makes it about them. That's why you only get posts. You never see posts about people truly giving their life to the Lord, because it's not just about a prayer. All you see is billboards, benches, cards, because it's all about self-righteous glory that comes back to him, linked to him, his website, t-shirts, pictures, because you see these hypocrites. You see these self-righteous, prideful Pharisees, wolves in sheep's clothing, exactly what the Lord Jesus Christ, Paul, told us to watch about in these last days. And it's the same thing, self-loving, envy, idolatry, greed, jealousy, and it's amazing to watch these stumbling stones become traps for themselves that lay out. So yeah, no, run, always like a run, just like a rat. Makes sense now. I mean, it always made sense. I mean it's not even worth my time. It's funny. Think that enemies thinking that he's sitting there messing and toying with them. In reality, the Lord's toying with them. They always say stuff like, oh, I'm feeling so convicted, I feel guilty. But you never hear him repent, because it's always the same. Just like they'll twist the scripture of the context, make it about works. They'll twist Matthew chapter 5 and Matthew chapter 13, where it's them in the storm. Try and say that the Lord sent them into the storm. The Lord did not send them into the storm. They'll try and say Job has access to heaven. Job does not have Job. They'll try and say in Job that the enemy has access to heaven. The enemy does not have free access to heaven. The enemy has to go with angels. It has to be by the Lord's will. Obviously, the Lord knows. But yeah, because it's no repentance. It's not about blood. It's not about the new birth. But that's what they forget, and what he forgets to realize when the disciples, when Peter was already saved, if you would. Obviously, the ghost hadn't been given up, but it's amazing, because I was reading something today. Actually, I want to show you guys. Let's just go there real quick, because I was reading it in Matthew, because I'm going to go into Timothy too. So, when Christ is talking right here and talking about the children, you see him right here. He called the little children to him, right? So we have the actual physical children. And then he says, "Assuredly I say, unless you are converted," new birth, "and become as little children, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven." So become as little children. So notice how he does it physically here with little children, because little children go to heaven. But become as. So he also applies it spiritual with the new birth. Very important. Because the disciples were already saved. Obviously, you just tie it in with the old covenant. I mean, they were still God's people. Christ just hadn't died for the sins yet, but he already knew. But what I want to show you guys, it says, "Therefore, whoever humbles himself as a little child," so as a little child, because you look at the character, the nature, innocent, pure, fully reliant on the Father, trustworthy, listens to the Father, grows with the Father, has that connection with the Father. "Whoever receives one little child like this in my name receives me." In the name, being baptized in the name of the Father, the name of the Son, and the name of the Holy Spirit. Okay, "whoever causes one of these little ones to sin," little ones, "who believes in me to sin, it would be better for him to have a millstone and were hung around his neck and he were drowned at the depths of the sea." So notice how Christ applies it here too. One of these little ones, so a little child, and then also a little child being innocent, but one who's born of God. So also one in the faith. So these false teachers, these Pharisees, these hypocrites who are leading people astray, leading those who are born of the Holy Spirit astray, who were new babes in Christ, he says it'd be better for them to take a millstone around the neck and be drowned at the depths of the sea. So Woe to the world because of the offenses, for offenses must come, but woe to that man by whom the offenses comes. Okay. So we see, and then this is what we see. Christ laying that foundation, obviously, by the Spirit. If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. How do you cut it off? You don't hack it off because it's the heart. You can still be sitting there limbless with the heart. I'm just going over this, guys, because we're going to eventually get to here. But you cut it off from the heart, and in doing so, you die to yourself. You die to yourself, you're born again in Christ. And if that happens, boom, cut it off. Give it to Christ. Continue going. Continue moving. Amazing. Take heed that you do not despise one of these little ones. For I say to you that in heaven, their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven. Their angels. More than one. Also, little children. Each little children has angels. But also, those born of the Spirit of God have angels who go with them. And they always see the face of the Father who's in heaven. And then what does he say here? For the Son of Man has come to save that which is lost. And that's the sheep right here. What do you think? So you see what he does here. He has the context and he lays it out as children, right? Physically. And then he applies it to that born of the Holy Spirit through the shepherd. So we have physical and spiritual. But he says right here, even so, it's not the will of your Father who is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish. So what I wanted to show you guys, just laying down the context, is we see actually little children, but then we see those born of the Holy Spirit. So applying here, Christ is looking at his disciples. And he says, even so, it is not the will of your Father. That's weird. I thought you had to be born of the Holy Spirit. You do. That's because they belong to Christ. They belong to God. That's why he's speaking to his disciples. He's laying it down physically as the children and then also with those born of the Holy Spirit. And he's speaking directly to them because it's new to them. Even so, it's not the will of your Father who is in heaven that one of these little ones physically and pointing to his disciples, one of these little ones, those ones and these ones. He's probably honestly holding, you know, kids on his lap, but looking at him. When he's looking at him, the way he's talking to him in a sense that it's, you know, how the Word of God does. He's the living Word of God, piercing their heart. So that's what I want to say. And then the enemy will, I just wanted to go here to show, the enemy will always try and say, oh yeah, it's always just about calling out. And that's what it is, because it's always just about a prayer. And I'm not saying if it came down to it, if those who truly called out to the Lord, but you see the foolishness and the prideful come out of it, because that's what I'm trying to apply here is the, if they're not born of the Holy Spirit, how can it be the Father? Well, it's because they belong to God. They were the children of God. It's because they were already saved. So the enemy will always try and take out repent, try and take out the blood, the new birth. And it's the same. So it's easy. So we can do this all day. And that's another thing. It's the same thing. Like, imagine needing to take 2 weeks just to get things right. Like, things don't seem right. Yeah, you think? You want to know why? Because he knows it's coming. Because he's high. It's fear. It's scared. And I'm not talking about the other one. I like the other guy. I like the other guy that preaches. He's cool. But it's funny. Could you imagine? Like every day. Like, and I'm not taking away from him because I like to listen to him preach. I think you should give him more time anyway. But I mean, hey, that's just, who am I? You know, it's not up to me. Who am I? Just saying. He's good. But imagine needing to take 2 weeks just to get things right. Like every week, every Sunday, you're not in that pulpit because you need to get things right. What's the matter? You see him flee because he knows what's coming. Just like a rat, scared and shining on because he knows. He knows it's the type of fear. What does the enemy do besides stab you in the back when he knows the entire church is going to flock together like they always do because it's a family. Enemy comes out and peeks out when it's the right moment, stabs and then runs and hides. Comes out, boop, and then runs and hides. Boop, and then runs and hides. And always tries to give himself a blessing and put himself in the context because he's jealous. He's jealous because whenever you have to put yourself in the context, it's never about you. Because it's never about you anyway. Like, I mean, obviously people will use the scriptures to kind of line it up with what's going on in the world, line it up with a certain character, with somebody. But whenever somebody inserts themselves in it, you can just tell, man. It's funny. They don't know the Lord whatsoever. And there's no blessings from the Lord whatsoever that would be nearly like Jacob and Esau. So, I just, like, I need to take 2 weeks because I'm not sure. Could you imagine? So, that's just a couple things that I just wanted to, but watch, you know. Yeah, it's, yeah, we'll see. We'll see when it comes back. I wonder. Probably going to be so... so funny. What a fraud. How easy. How simple. Now let's get into some true prophecy. That's what I wanted to show you guys. Because the enemy will always try and use this too. Because it's all about this lining that up to Christ coming. Laying the foundation by the new covenant. Being born of the Spirit. I want to go to Timothy and show you guys what I was reading. Okay. So Paul says to Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 4. He says in verse 14, "Do not neglect the gift that is given to you." Because what we see here and what happens here, obviously, because that's the difference between the Old Testament people who spoke directly to God and those who have the Holy Spirit through prophecy, is God speaking through them. Because when you take, because Christ is the spirit of prophecy, Christ is the last prophet. All the Old Testament prophets spoke to God, spoke to Christ, and saw the angel of the Lord. The same Spirit, the same Holy Spirit that's alive inside of us, same God, Spirit of God, Spirit, the Holy Ghost of Christ, that speaks through. Paul prophesied, Peter prophesied, John prophesied. How do they prophesy? By the Spirit of the living God, by the Holy Spirit. So that's what I'm saying, even though, you know, I think Timothy's gift actually was prophecy. Wasn't it? Because that's what it is. A gift of prophecy, and then also what we see in Corinthians. But that's what it is. How is the gift of prophecy? True prophecy. Not saying that everyone out there. I'm just saying true prophecy. If it is given to them by the Spirit of God. So there's no actual prophets anymore because Christ is the last prophet. But that last prophet is inside each one of us. And if it's because that prophet, the spirit of prophet, which is Christ, is the same spirit that the prophet, the Old Testament prophets spoke to, God himself, he's the one now alive inside of us. So he's the one that's prophesying. So let's get into a true prophecy. And real quick too, let's just get into the Lord for prayer. Just glorify his name, lift his name up. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much, Lord. Thank you so much for the family, Lord, for your family, for the body of Christ. And they're so amazing. It's so amazing watching them, Lord. And it's everything that you are, and you alive in us, you alive in me. And I can look at them, watch your people and family. And have that same standard and character, characteristic that you have. And that, and obviously not as much. It'll never be as much. But I now have that standard of how you see him. And man, it's so amazing. I just thank you so much. It's just true family, Lord. Thank you for keeping them strong. Thank you for allowing us to come together in your name, your spirit working through all of them, even those who we don't see, those who work behind the scenes, those who are doing worship, those who are taking care of the children. Lord, it's your spirit that works inside your people, and it's all together because you're the spirit of the living God, because you are alive. And that's what's different. That's what separates everybody else and every other false religion who don't have your spirit, is it all moves and works together. And it's just so amazing, Lord. I lift your name up and I glorify you through them, through everything that you're doing, even in the midst of the storm. That's another thing. Thank you, Lord. We're going to go over that real quick. And I just thank you, Lord, and just ask that you would speak through me. Ask that you would guide me. Anything that you, what you had me lay down, what you had me show, Lord, nothing that I could ever do. It's you. And I just glorify you. I lift your name up and I thank you for this time. And just ask that you would speak through me. Ask that you would guide me. Anything you want us to see, allow us to put it all together. And I just thank you, Lord. I love you so much. In your holy name, amen. Right on. So what we saw before, and that's another thing too. The Lord God did not send his disciples into the storm. There's a difference. When you actually get to the context of it, which we will, because he'll never actually show it, because that's the difference. You got to be careful, because when they don't show it, they can just say anything. I don't know why I went there. Okay, right here. So in Matthew chapter 8, verse 23. Now when he got into the boat, his disciples followed him, and suddenly a great tempest arose on the sea. So a tempest is a storm, a hurricane. Christ is in the middle of the storm with them, because there isn't, he will never send us in the middle of the storm. So when we see when the enemy will try and twist this out of context. Okay, yeah, right here. So when he sent the multitudes away, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. So he was praying, wasn't watching the disciples. Obviously, he's God. Context, Christ. Fully man, fully God. He's praying to the Father. Now, the boat was now in the middle of the sea, and it was tossed by the waves. So it wasn't a storm, it was tossed by the waves. Obviously, by the wind. For the wind was contrary. So it's not a storm, it's a wind, but it was there's waves. As anytime you go out on the sea, it wasn't a tempest. That's the difference. Because the enemy will try and tell you it's about works, just like he'll try and tell you that you're in the middle of the storm without Christ. And you'll never be in the middle of the storm without Christ. So. All right, let me go over and let me show you guys. And I'm going to kind of go over and kind of skim like what already. But you see it's this with the crystal and the type of forehead. So I'm going to kind of go over. It's the type of a mark, right? Type of an element stone. Now this crystal type is a universal crystal quartz linking it together, but it's red. Red, a type of sard onyx, just like what we see, but how is it with white and red making pink? Just like the type of red with Esau, the red dragon, and a blood, obviously the Savior giving his blood. So white mixed, obviously, with that red, that purity, if you would. You get that pink, that feminine, that lotus. But it's also linked to the tribe of Benjamin. So that which is the kingdom of Judah. The two tribes that were left, Judah and Benjamin. You look at the Gemini, that duality. As above, so below, light and dark. It's the same with the Kabbalah teaches. Find that medium. Just like man and woman type of beast right in the center. That's what they teach, finding the spirit of the power of the air. And it's linked. Obviously, we went over the agate stone, because the agate is crystal and quartz, and it's linked all types of colors. And how is it? By the bloodstone, the sardonyx, onyx, beryl, quartz, linked to crystal, all can be laced with gold. Obviously, we know how gold is, how gold's worked over time. Real quick, I want to show you. So, we're going to go to Strong's Greek crystal and ice. Let me see here. But I want to show you how I got this, actually. Sorry. So I went to... I just did it backwards. It was crystal. So the strong Greek meaning for crystal would be ice. Isis. But also just like a polar opposite, if you would. We're going to link it to just the elements of the world, the 12 elements of the world. And, you know, you start with four because it's all working your way up. And enlightenment, up the chakras, up the mandibles, up the spine, because it's enlightening to your third eye. And it's all by the elements. Fire being one of them. Kundalini fire. Wind, earth, fire and water. And then just we'll link it. We'll get to it real quick, but just showing you ice and Isis. So, just a type of ice. Did polar ice opposite, you know, and like strong Hebrews ice. Frost. Crystal. So, ice. So that's where the Lord was showing me a type of ice crystal. Hail, just the prince of the power of the air. Resembles rock. And that's where he was leading me to the stones and just linking the elements. And it's all linked to astrology, all linked to the stones. And it's all by the nature, the matter, the quartz, beryl, onyx, crystalline. And it's all you think. You look at what they worship, the gold, they worship the rubies, the diamonds, the emeralds, put together all the matter of the world. Different continents, that's what it's going to be linked to. Ice, Antarctica, Egypt over here, you know. Astrology, the 12 stars. So you link it as above and you link it as so below. And you do so with the stones. So when you link the stars, just like the false prophet through the Antichrist will link the stars up together, bringing the 12 tribes together, a type of Christ. As above, he will also do so below. You have the elements. So just like I tried to tell you guys, I apologize because it seems like I'm spoon feeding you here with a shovel. But it's like when we look at Moses and with ruling with his rod, his natural rod, his staff, and then you look at a Christ, obviously Moses, type of Christ, ruling with the rod of iron. Then you look at King David right in the center, a foreshadow of Christ, a foreshadow of bringing both spiritual and physical. New, physical and spiritual. Old, new. Law, grace. And what's the foundation? Christ is always the foundation. And it's just like what we see when Christ came, when you transformed on Mount Tabor, a foreshadow and a coming of his return with Moses and Elijah, I believe is the two prophets that we see in Revelation. You have the natural branch, Moses, and you have Elijah, who had a little bit of Gentile blood in him, the olive who was grafted in. So when we look at King David and a type of foreshadow coming of the King of Israel, a type of Christ to come, the one to bring the 12 tribes together. The enemy obviously knows this. You have, what does David say? I think it's Psalm 23. As I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for your rod and your staff are with me. So you have that physical and you have the spiritual. The Christ, Moses obviously being a type of Christ, that staff and the rod together, boom, right in the center. That's what they do. So when you have the stars, you have it linked together. It's the same with the ground. And it's the same with linking the continents, seven continents, just like seven major religions. 7 points of Ishtar, the seven kingdoms. You link it together. The stones from over here, the element from over here. There's ice over here. As above, so below. Finding that medium. So the ice crystal stone is actually used for the third eye, the crown, the soul chakras. And let's go here too. I'll kind of go over this. I'll go over what I have here. Nearly invisible in water. Let me see. Okay, so shamanic work. So shamans. And that's how you get the paganism, Hinduism, Buddhism, psychedelics all linked together. Solar activities. It's about bioscalar energy, waves for multidimensional interstellar healing on all levels. So Prince of the Power of the Air. Physical, the crystal stimulates. So notice too, it's the elements. Opposite, light and dark, fire, ice. That which is claiming to be God. Paganism, if you would. Linking to the earth. So the higher vibrational energy downloads can be more easily integrated and assimilated, as it's especially beneficial during these times in heightened solar activity where these downloads are coming fully in intensity into our world. The scalar waves embedded in these healing crystals illuminate and magnify the abrasions found in the human genome. Hereditary, I don't know why I wanted to say something else. Information in the human body, these imperfections and caused by traumatic experience in our multidimensional timelines and the origins of abnormalities and disease in physical body, especially those of genetic blood lineage basis. So honestly, too, a type of tribulation. How easy is it going to be now with the wrath of God for people to link to this and to search for something even more as time goes on? But once they are smoothed out of the I've got loyalty inside my what? All the enemy. These blemishes can be corrected. The natural forms can emerge. So I don't want fire and ice, because I didn't really care to look up the fire. I mean, we kind of already can get an idea. You guys can look at this more. I was just showing you what I was going to. Oh, that's, yep, there you go. That's what it all comes down to, the sun worship. Egypt, ancient Egypt, the opposite of the S-O-N. Water cult cold air. Obviously, a type of temp making it, you have to have hot and cold. Type of the prince of the power of the air, that fire and ice. So then I went to the four elements of the earth, which is fire, water, wind, and earth. Four type of beasts that we see in Daniel chapter 7, being a type of the prince of the power of the air, that which is to come. And then you have the eight elements of nature. So you have the four elements of nature. And it's, notice how it's an enlightenment. It's a step up. It's the chakras. It's up the spine, the awakening, the enlightenment. You start with four, then you can go to eight, and then what links to 12? How about the Kabbalah tree of life, 12 points? And it's all the 12 tribes of Israel, but linking it together with the seven kingdoms and with the 10 points and what the Lord is showing us. But you work it up, you gradually work it up, and it all links to the cabal. And I can say that too, and I only say that because they'll try and flag it, try and get it for anti-Semitism. And I'm Jewish, so they can try. Also, cold, cold death, cold in your heart, The world gets that, but a type of fog too. Think about cold air, fog. It's, thick, not pure. Just a type of think about it. It's like fog with that air, with breath. Obviously, us being fallen beings in the world, that fog, that mixture. It's almost like a type of light, like a. You see the white to it, that type of white, but it's not, Still got carbon dioxide. Because the gas is there. So then you just work your way up. So eight. So you have the seventh, obviously, that we see in Daniel 2 with the four. Here, let's go to Daniel real quick and just look at it. So you see the four beasts. Awesome. Coming of Christ. Oh, you know what? Sorry. Just to get that, let's go to. You know what? My mistake. Right. Seven heads, ten horns. The seven heads of the seven mountains. Obviously, linking that to the Vatican where the woman sits. Five type. See the 10 points. 10 points are back to Daniel. That's why I apologize going back and forth. It's you go to Daniel, Revelation, Daniel, because that's how they just smack in. But okay. So then I just wanted to show you guys this then too. You have the eight elements. Your way up. Notice what it's doing here. You're starting to get your sigil type. Okay, so you have the 12 elements of nature, right? All under Satan, right? And I listed them all too, so I'll just you can see them just right here actually. Electricity, ice, fear, under, crazy, huh? Poison, light, convexity. Ooh, just kidding. That's cool. Not. So you just the seven continents, right? North and South America. Europe, Asia, Africa, Australia, and Antarctica. The stones, the minerals, the type of elements from each continent around the world. Antarctica ice, you know, a major part. And that's another thing why I linked ice out of it being a major part. Don't exactly, it's just what they have and have hidden and what's there. So then now what I'm going to show you too, linking up, because the quantum dot tattoo through quantum light, it's all going to link to the Star of David. So you have the history of the yellow star, right, which is inscribed with Jude, which Jude is Jews in German. Oh, yeah, and that's why you always hear the, oh, yeah, the power up, level up. Leveling up, you know, like working way up. Here's your seven continents, too. It's funny how they link the colors in there, too. Almost like a rainbow. So you have the Kabbalah Tree of Life. All, it's what it comes down to, the esoteric hidden meaning, the devil. So you have the yellow star of Jude, right? For Nazi persecution, right? For Holocaust, execution of Jews, God's people. All murder, evil, right? Wickedness. It, very interesting. The badge was instituted in 1933 when Hitler came to power. All mockery. Very key. So, war, right? Also very key. What brought this in? War brought this in. Used all throughout Europe, right? And that's what we're gonna link it to, the dragon. We're gonna link it to Esau through Cain, and we're gonna link it to the mark. So what I was showing you and where I ended, remember where the Lord, actually, this, I'll show you guys this too, because I took a screenshot of one of the guys that I watch on YouTube that you guys can look up if you want, but it's what we're seeing today type. But just like with that, here, let me show you. Right here, looking into the right, the cardinal, the Pope, the cardinals, the red Esau, red dragon. Here's your bloodstone, your root chakra, the main, the core, right, the foundation. What's, where did he get this symbol? Also, too, there's never anything in the scripture that mentions David having a star. So what it is, it's two invert, it's an inverted pyramid. Or a triangle, two triangles, as above, so below, making 6 points. It's gonna, we're gonna link it to the Temple of Solomon. But that gold star of David, exactly what's gonna link to the quantum technology the enemy's gonna have. That's your pyramids. You're seeing half of it, because they have quantum, the quantum technology through quantum laser. They're gonna use to tattoo. Same laser and equipment they had, technology they had to make and carve those stones, where they got it from. But they have the quantum sculpting today where it turns invisible, a type that you can't see it. The enemy has something that's like that. So when he comes, he's going to link this gold Star of David through the pyramids. It's all a sigil, right? The Baphomet. It's where you're going to get into your mandibles. And linking up the chakras, the spine. So then, with these triangles too, right? Kabbalah, light and dark. With the pyramids, you have, they're two overlaid triangles. and they're inverted. It's all about backwards, all about opposite, as above, so below, finding that balance that I'm drawing a blank on it. Vesica Pisces, I think it is. Or the yin and yang. But, so with the pyramid, right? Because it all links to the Kabbalah. The three points, three entities. It's all a copy of the Father, Son, and Spirit. Only, it's, with us, it's three different persons, all one God, all one being, one essence. With them, it's three different. It's not an entity. So that's what's different too with what the Kabbalah is and what they link it to, is it's a type of entity. The Father is not an entity. Father's God. So, and that's another thing too, that through a, you know, that physical world and spiritual, linking it together through a quantum rift, that's how they're going to bring him, the bringing the devil over. That's what you're seeing at CERN through Shiva. They think, the people who are just puppets think that it's Shiva. In reality, it's the devil, Satan. So we see the Pope. I wanted to show you the Pope with this gold Star of David, because it's what it's going to come down to. You see that physical and the spiritual. The Star of David symbolizes both dimensions. The mystical significance, right? Six-pointed star, two overlaid equilateral triangles. Okay, so this is where I got everything. And this is why I show you guys, so you guys can find it. Because this is where the Lord takes me and shows me. Okay, so double triangle, the Star of David, symbolized the connection of both dimensions. Titus, please stop, bud. Hey, wake up, bud. Good boy. So you have the 6 points, also a six wing type of cherubim, an anointed cherubim, if you would have fallen, but it's all through the spine, and it absorbs the 6 points. Same with the seven, the type of kundalini, the chakras, the new age, and that's how you work it up. That's why with the Hindus, they're one step lower. It's almost like a watered down, if you would, from the Kabbalah. And it's all working your way up, but it's linked to the same. But the star of this gold, in this gold Star of David that we see the Pope with, and where it comes from, and where we see that it's just a mockery. That's what it is. It's a mockery. It's a mock of our Savior. It's a mock of the Jews with the Holocaust, with God's people. Type of false teaching, and then a mock of the mark that's to come. It's always the same, always. So we see that with the Pope, with the gold. Interesting too, and you see the hat. What did you see? You see the hat, the Akhenaten hat. That ancient Egyptian, that they would say aliens, the little green spacemen. Yeah, they're not aliens, those are demons. Where do you think they get the knowledge from? Where do you think the enemy gets the knowledge from? He just copies it and takes it for himself. So, no scripture says that David used a star, the enemy. Oh, these are the fake Jews, that which is of the synagogue of Satan, the Jesuits. So the hexagram, right? The hexagram, the Baphomet. Your sigil, your points, your mandibles. And they're called, I call them mandibles because it's a type of bug. I'm referencing Revelation, but they're mandalas. But it's all just a show, a front type of working up your spine right here. Because it's a front. Because it's a front for the enemy. It's your Hindu, Buddhist. There's your sigil, your star, There's everything right here. Paganism, your lotus. Right? Your Baphomet, your satanic sigil. What do you see? They say, I don't even under. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. There we go. Thank you, Lord. The Catholic wine glass. Wine glass. The Catholic. Sorry, guys. It's time for bed. The Catholic stained glass. Wine glass. That's going to be the next thing. Oh, he's. There you go. There you go. Man, ridiculous. So yeah, it's just a false Judaism, right? The beast type of four stars. But what do you see in a type of psychedelics? Kaleidoscope patterns. Same thing, all linked. The spiritual world. You have Indian bindis, right? You have the history of the mandalas. You have Buddhism mandalas. You have Hinduism mandalas, you have Islam mandalas, Christian mandalas. Satanic mandalas. Sacred geometry, this is what it comes down to, Metron. This is your false. This is your Antichrist. This is the devil. This is Lucifer. And I only do that because his name isn't Lucifer anymore, it's Satan. Metatron kind of sounds like a Biden. You go, the Tanakh, the Kabbalah, for Enoch, name that Enoch was. Here you go, here's your false Christ, there's your Antichrist. That would be Lucifer coming as an angel of light. Right there. I don't know why it's doing this. Sorry, guys. This is a stone. You see the stone on his head? What's that? Would that be a red sardonic stone? In gold? It's just on top like a crown. See the planets? You're Apollyon. So you literally have Abaddon and Apollyon. Man, I glorify you, Lord. You're so amazing, Lord. So, real quick, too, just wanted to go over a couple things. The Babylonians, the Egyptians, the Assyrians all used of idolatry for the six-pointed star. Because it's the star gods, right? What it is, astrology, the star gods. Ah, oh, darn it. Oh, well, thank you, Lord. I'll find it later. You're the one who led me here, Lord. If I can't find it again, I won't need it, Lord. Oh, yeah, Isaiah. I think it's Isaiah 14, 12. Here, let's just go to the scriptures. I think it's Isaiah 14. Maybe not. Man, I go to it so many times, you'd think I just know. It's just late. Sorry, guys. Son of the morning, fallen from heaven. You know what? Right here. Some verses just. Because it's not, you see how they twist it. This is why it's very important. Which version of the scriptures you have. It's all about the star, right? So the star gods, you have Solomon, and it's the talisman of Saturn, right? Saturn, Satan, just like I showed we went over before. Many amazing truthers led by the Spirit of God have shown, fighting for the faith, showing the enemy. But you have that hexagram kaleidoscope patterns that you see with psychedelics. You see the Jesuit Rothschild bankers use it for a theft. You have the Luciferians, you have witches, Satanists, astrologers. They all use it, linking demonic powers when they use their sigils and they use do sacrifices. And you have the false Star of David and the false Christ. And getting into the Mark of Cain, also a punishment. Interesting, Mark of Cain that we see in Genesis 4. Israel adopted the six-pointed star in the wilderness due to their apostasy. The mark of Cain was worshipped by the Israelites in the wilderness as the star. Okay, we're going to come right back to that, but we're going to come to the Star of Rephaim. So that's what it comes down to. No, why? Sorry, guys. Let me see. Thanks for bearing with me. Right here, Cain's mark. Very interesting. Red, right? Mark of Cain. Cain was not to be killed, also. Notice what happened to the type of offering. That which is those who have accepted Christ and those who haven't, and those who wanted works. A mark, right? Cain was not to be killed. Abel was a type of Christ that was killed, murdered, type of sacrifice, but hated, right? And it was how long hated? Well, let's go to the scriptures, but seven times. That's type of 7-year tribulation. So let's go here real quick. Okay. Now Adam knew his Eve and his wife she conceived and bore Cain and said, I've acquired a man from the Lord. Okay. Abel, his brother, and killed him. Okay, so the Lord said to Cain, where's Abel, your brother? And he said, I don't know. Am I my brother's keeper? And he said, what have you done? The voice of your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. That's crazy. There's life in the blood. That's a type of Christ. God knowing it and knowing those who belong to him. The blood of him cries out to me from the ground. Know that the Lord knows. So now you are cursed from the earth, which has opened its mouth to receive the bl your or your brother's blood from your hand. When you till the ground, you shall no longer yield its strength to you, and a fugitive and a vagabond you shall be on earth. And Cain said, Lord, my punishment is greater than I can bear. You know what that sounds like, guys? That sounds like in Revelation with those who receive the mark, the wrath of God, and want to kill themselves, seek to kill themselves, but yet death flees from them. Kind of sounds like they cannot bear because of what they've rejected and killed the Lord in their heart. So yeah, men will seek death in those days, but will not find it. Those who have the mark. So Cain says, right? What is Cain gonna say? My punishment's greater than I can bear. Type of Satan and God's people. So what do we see? Let's go to Acts chapter 7 because this is what it is linking down to and what the Lord's showing me. Acts chapter 7, we're gonna wrap it up. Chapter 7, verse 43. Yeah, so this is Stephen on trial too, on trial. But so he's okay, I'm gonna start in verse I think 40. Okay. I'm going to start in verse 42. Then God turned and gave them up to worship the host of heaven that's written in the book of prophets. Did you offer me slaughtered animals and sacrifice during 40 years in the wilderness to the house of Israel? You also took up the tabernacle of Moloch and the star of your god Rimpham. Images which you made to worship, I will carry you away beyond Babylon. So, very interesting, very important. The star of Rimpham in the wilderness, worshipped by the children of Israel, linking to the mark of Cain. It's the same as the beginning. So when you see the mark and you see what they worshipped, the star, what we're going to see in the end, the same star, the same type of Cain, the same type of mark through the blood. And I mean that by red, by the nature, honestly, probably a type of tattoo that was put into him, the punishment, and then linking it to what it will be and what it is here with the Moloch and Baal and the Satan. So then what I want to show you guys, the quantum laser, the same laser that they're going to use to mark. Quantum laser turns energy lost, energy, sun, solar, into gain. 3. Red and blue. Purple, make your royalty. Awesome. So, this is what the Lord was showing me and just how I'm linking it. And now that we can have that context, laying it down now through star, what I'm going to do, honestly, is what I'll probably just get a little bit more into detail of linking it all together. What I went over in the past, what the Lord was showing me, how it all links together. This. But then probably also showing you the Antichrist too, with link with the false prophet. And just how it all links, so. There'll be more, and I just know if it's the Lord's will, when his time is and what he chooses, and just lining up now, that we're kind of getting in context, lining it up to the actual tattoo and the mark. So, yeah, let's just praise the Lord God, thank him for our time, and I'm going to go get to bed. Man, I need my barbiturates. Just kidding, guys. Lord Jesus, I just thank you so much. I just lift your name up, Lord. I thank you for who you are. I thank you for your word, your spirit that's alive in us, your body, the family, Lord. I just thank you so much for them, Lord. I thank you so much for you and that we can come together in your name and lift your name up. See the spirit working through us, keeping us together, keeping us strong, bold as a family, living to serve you, living to worship and praise you, work for you, being at peace and total rest in the midst of these times, and just knowing that it's short. And I just thank you that you're with us and you're always with us, and you're the one who protects us. You're the one who guides us and walks with us, and you're alive in us. And I just thank you so much for allowing me to do this, allowing me to praise you and glorify you. It's all your glory. It's all your praise. And I just thank you, Lord, and I thank you for who you are. I thank you that you're just alive working in the world, and I know that time is short, and I just thank you for the family, Lord, in your name, and that we can just keep strong, keep bold, and just glorify you. That's what it's about, Lord. I love you so much. Thank you. Thank you for who you are, Lord, in your holy name. Amen. Right on, guys. So I'll probably see you tomorrow, Lord willing, and if I don't see you tomorrow, I will see you the next day, Lord willing. God bless you guys. Have a good night.